Hey, good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for tuning in today with us here at City Soul Ministries. My name is Luke Easter. I'm the lead pastor here at the church. If this is your first Sunday with us, welcome. We would love to be able to connect with you, and a great way to do that is to go to our website. You can fill out a connect card there, connect with us, tell us you're here today, you know, share any prayer requests you have, any questions you have, possibly about the church, about your faith. You know, maybe you're looking into baptism. You know, just maybe got some questions about your faith or different things. We would love to be able to connect with you. Our website is a great resource. You can also go to our website. You can give your offering or your tithe that way securely. You can also mail your tithe check, your offering check to City Soul Ministries, 1101 46th Street here in Vienna, 26105, or you can give any amount, text to give to 84321. So thank you so much for tuning in today. We are going to jump in today to our series to the Gospel of John. John chapter 16, verses 25 through 33. You know, it doesn't take very long for us to take a look around at this world and to see the hopelessness of fallen humanity. You know, people try to satisfy their need to be loved and accepted and to have peace in their hearts and their lives by the cheap thrills and the schemes of this world, of Satan. You know, everything in this world is perishing. You know, there's no eternal hope or peace in a political system or party. You know, there's no lasting peace or hope in obtaining lots of money and having lots of things in this life. There's no significant an eternal peace or hope in anything that this world has to offer. Now, when we say this term, the world, that is referring to the evil systems of this world. The simple principle is this: the world, the way of the world, the way of the evil systems of the world, of Satan, it's kind of like fool's gold. Y'all know what fool's gold is. You know, fool's gold looks like it's real. It looks great. It appears on the surface that it's great and it's going to give you riches, and you're like, oh my goodness, I've found something very valuable here. But whatever, sometimes what looks good on the outside isn't always going to deliver. And that's the way the systems of the world is. As they shine, they glitter, they look like they're going to make you happy. But in the end, all of what we see is perishing. Today in our series through the Gospel of John, Jesus gives his disciples the ultimate peace, the ultimate acceptance that we all need, and that is that he has overcome this world. He's overcome the system of this world. He's overcome sin. He's overcome the grave, and he's done what you and I could never do. Our faith in his atoning work upon the cross brings us back to a right relationship with God, you know, a love from God. It gives a purpose to our lives that's second to none, and it brings us a hope and a peace that nothing in this world can ever take from us. We can never be snatched from the Father's hand. Today we're going to finish up here in chapter 16. We're going to start with verse 25 and we're going to go to verse 33. But we're going to start out with verse 25 today. This section is entitled, I Have Overcome the World. And Jesus is speaking again to his disciples on the night before his crucifixion. And this is what he says. He says, I have said these things to you in figures of speech. The hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figures of speech, but will tell you plainly about the Father. So we'll stop there. Jesus has been dropping these absolute truth bombs upon the ears of his disciples up until this point. If you've been with us through our series in the Gospel of John, he's spoken to them about a lot of different things that their minds just really couldn't even fully understand. He's talked to them about the reality of the hatred of the world that they will experience because they are his followers, that they will be hated because they are Jesus's disciples. He talked to them about the work of the Holy Spirit that was to come. He talked about abiding in him and that his true disciples will abide in him and keep his commands and love him. He's told them that he is going to die. He's going to go and to prepare a place for them in the Father's house, and he will return for them. I mean, that's just a really quick synopsis of just a few things that Jesus has talked about here in the Gospel of John. So many deep truths that he has just been lavishing upon their ears and their hearts, and their minds just really fully can't grasp or totally understand. everything that he's saying. Now, this term, figures of speech, literally means he was speaking in a veiled way, a veiled way. Jesus has been speaking to them in these veiled terms. Now, you must remember that these guys are living right in the middle of all of this. Yet they don't have the luxury that you and I have this morning of knowing all the events that are about to unfold and reading those and studying those. I mean, they're literally living right in the middle of it. You know, they're right in the middle of how this is all going to unfold. All of these things that Jesus has been telling them would not make much sense to them. Some of them wouldn't make much sense until after his death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension back to heaven, and then the sending of the Holy Spirit. Then they would look back and they would remember these things and understand them more clearly. Their faith would be strengthened even more by the work of the Holy Spirit. So in just a few short weeks, they would actually understand Jesus' words more so. His ministry, the things that he'd been teaching them, his life. They would understand these things more than they did when they were actually with him. So hindsight for the disciples here would, of course, be 20/20. After all these events unfold, after the Holy Spirit is given at Pentecost in just a few short weeks, all of these things would make way more sense. Let's move on to verse 26 and 28. Jesus goes on to say, "In that day, you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will ask the Father on your behalf. For the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. I came from the Father and have come into the world, and now I am leaving the world and going to the Father." Again here, Jesus is just within hours of his arrest and his crucifixion. You know, the whole world has been waiting and yearning for this hour, the hour of redemption and the whole reason why Jesus came into this world. After it's all done, after Jesus dies upon the cross, bears the sins of the world, is buried and raises again and ascends back to heaven, they are then to ask the Father in Jesus' name. Jesus is making it clear what he meant by telling them to pray in his name. He's trying to teach the disciples, and he's, of course, teaching you and he's teaching me today, that the Father loves his children. He loves you and he loves me. He wants to hear from us. He wants us to talk to him, to pray to him, and he wants to have a relationship with us. When we ask in Jesus' name, as my study Bible states it, it says this way, when we ask in Jesus' name, this simply means that we are asking on the basis of his merit, speaking of Christ's merit, Christ's righteousness, and for whatever would honor and glorify him as to build his kingdom. In other words, Jesus is saying here to his disciples, if you think that I have to ask the Father to be good to you and to be generous to you as his children, you're wrong. The Father himself loves you. I don't have to ask him to love you. He already loves you. The Father isn't hard to get along with if you are his child. He loves you, and that is the reason he will answer your prayer, and you are to pray in my name, as Jesus says. You know, if I was to speculate today, you know, kind of go out on a limb here and just give a kind of an overall assessment, I would say that most of you listening to this message today, your prayer life really needs to improve. Your prayer life really isn't where it needs to be. For many Christians, prayer life is kind of reduced to two times a day. And oftentimes it's before we have a meal. And there's nothing wrong. I mean, we always pray at my household. You know, we're out to eat or we're at the house. We always pray. But oftentimes that prayer is reduced to just a kind of monotonous, you know, saying the same thing over again. And it's just kind of a quick prayer and you just dive into your food. And it's not a real, you know, intimate, not a real wordy prayer. It's just kind of like, you know, Lord, thank you for this food. Amen. And it's just very quick and rushed. And there's nothing wrong with that. But I'm just saying that maybe that's all the prayer time that you're having throughout the day. For others, maybe they even pray before bed at night. And that's good. I pray every evening with my kids. But oftentimes what happens is we lay down and, you know, we turn the TV off and we put our phone down and we attempt to say a prayer of thanksgiving to our Heavenly Father. And before we even get our words out, you know, we fall asleep. Church, do you understand that we have the unspeakable privilege of coming to the Father in Jesus' name? When the Holy Spirit came and comes in our lives and takes up residence in our lives, we can now go directly to the Father. If you are a Christian this morning, if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, then you can come to the Father in Jesus' name. Now, to the Jewish people of that day, this was a foreign principle because God, they thought, was very distant. But see, when Jesus died upon the cross, you know, the veil was torn, signifying now access to God in Jesus' name. Direct access to God now in the name of Jesus. I think it's safe to say, and it's safe to say in my life and probably yours as well, that our prayer lives can constantly be improving. We need to take advantage of this truth today to ask. And if it's consistent with the will of the Father responds. See, you don't need a priest. You don't need to pray to Mary, as the Roman Catholic Church believes. No, we don't need that. We don't do that. We come to the Father in Jesus' name. God loves us so that we can come to Him and ask anything that is consistent with His sovereign will. Every good thing God wants to give us because of Christ. He loves His own. He loves us in a special way. He loves us like family. We belong to Him when we are in Christ. Not only does He love His own, I mean, stop and think about this for a second. He likes us. He wants to have a relationship with us. He continually and eternally loves you. For those who belong to Him in Christ, He loves you. And aren't you glad this morning? I mean, aren't you glad that He loves you? That I'm loved by God, that you are loved by God if you are in Christ? This type of love is reserved for all who belong to Him. You know, if God loves me like that, and I believe that God loves me like that, that's really all I need. You know, if people don't like me, if I'm not popular in the world, if I don't receive praise from others, I don't care. If my Heavenly Father loves me, then that's all I need. Here's the deal. He loves you like this because He's God, and you have your faith in Jesus Christ, and He loves you like this even though He knows everything about you. Everything about you He knows, and He still loves you. You know, you don't know everything about me, and I don't know everything about you. And, you know, we love each other. But when we start to kind of learn things about people and maybe some of the decisions they've made in the past or some of the lifestyles that they've lived, and now they're out of that, and you kind of look back and you're like, hey, I don't know about that. You know, we're very unlovable at times, but our Heavenly Father loves us, even though He knows everything about us. Well, the question simply is how do we get God to love us like this? You know, what's the way? How do I get God to love me like this? Well, the answer is to love Jesus. When we love Jesus, the Father's Son, the Father in turn loves us. And we love Jesus by obeying Him. Jesus said it earlier, if you love me, the Father will love you. These promises are crystal clear throughout the Gospel of John. That is what it means to be a Christian, to love the Lord Jesus Christ, and then to be obedient to Him. Jesus has said it here clearly. The Father loves you because you have loved me and have believed that I came from the Father. You believe that Jesus has come from the Father, and you love Him. These guys have believed that Jesus was God's Son, that He was sent from the Father. This is the simplest foundational understanding of who Christ is, that He was born into this world, that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, that He was God who came into this world, that He came and lived a perfect life, went to the cross for the work of redemption, He rose again, and He went back to the Father. See, it's not enough just to say, hey, yeah, Jesus was a good teacher. I hear a lot of people say that, right? Even people in, you know, other religions and other religious structures, you know, they'll even acknowledge, yeah, you know, Jesus was a good teacher. Jesus was a nice guy. But if that's all we see Jesus as, that's totally missing the mark of who he was. Jesus was God. Jesus was sent by God, and he did the atoning work of dying for our sins. He came from heaven, and what he's saying here is, I'm going back to heaven. And the disciples believe that, and this morning I just simply ask you, do you believe that? Well, listen to how the disciples respond here to the clear and concise words from Jesus in verses 29 through 30. As we read here in verses 29 through 30, the disciples said back, "Ah, now you are speaking plainly and not using figurative speech. Now we know that you know all things and do not need anyone to question you. This is why we believe that you came from God." So they get it now. You know, it's not veiled. It's simple what's happening here. They're starting to get it. They believed that Jesus was God in human flesh. And that's great. I'm so thankful. And we see that the disciples' faith was genuine, was real. But it's not the end of the story here for these disciples of what's going to happen in just a few short hours. Listen to how Jesus responds to their confession of belief. As we read ahead here to verse 31, let's look at what verse 31 tells us as he says back to the disciples, says, "Jesus answered them, 'Do you now believe?'" Jesus is affirming their belief, but then he's about to say that, hey, that's not going to come without you guys, your guys' world about to be rocked. Your faith, your very minute faith is about to be rocked here in the next few hours. Listen to what Jesus says in verses 32 through 33. He says, "Behold, the hour is coming. Indeed, it has come, when you will be scattered, each to his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, for the Father is with me. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world." These guys would very soon, in the next few short hours, be running away from this whole situation. Jesus is about to be arrested. The disciples would scatter. They would run away. They left Jesus and ran away as quickly as possible. These men were scared and in doubt and fearful. Jesus affirmed their belief, even though they were going to scatter here in just a little while. He knew that they were true believers. Their faith was very weak, but they still had faith. You and I would like to believe that our faith is going to stay 100% strong, even when struggle and trial and temptation comes. Sometimes it will stay strong, but there will be other times where your faith will be shaken to the core. It may cause you some questioning. It may even scatter you like the disciples were scattered. But the simple question is this, is when that struggle, that trial, that tragedy, whatever it was came, did you return to your faith? Even though it was shaken, even though the times were tough, that faith was still there. Jesus is telling these guys, hey, you're going to run. You're going to scatter. There's going to be some moments here in the next few days where you're going to really struggle in your faith. But their faith was real, even though their faith was very weak. Their faith was immature. It needed to be refined. It needed growth, and it needed maturity. They believed the right thing about Jesus, but their faith was still very weak. This just tells us today, kind of in closing, that we need to be very humble in our lives. These men's faith would be strengthened in just a few short days when they would see the resurrected Christ, and a few short weeks later when the Holy Spirit would be sent to them. We have the promise that the Lord holds on to us. Listen to this very carefully. The Lord holds on to us even when our faith is weak. Even when we feel like our world is being rocked, he holds on to his own. He does not let us go. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. We've talked about this huge doctrine of the perseverance of the saints through the Gospel of John, is that the good shepherd will get us there. He's not going to lose anyone. The Father will get us there. But that doesn't mean that there's not going to be times of struggle. He's holding on to his own this morning. The final words of Jesus here is he wants his disciples, he wants you and I to have peace. We started out this message today talking about how the world doesn't have peace and they search in all the wrong places. And the peace that we have as Christians is salvation and our faith in Jesus Christ. The peace of knowing that Jesus has overcome this world. He's overcome Satan and sin and the grave. Jesus has already won. The battle is already decided. You want to have peace this morning? You want to be on the winning team? Then today put your faith in Jesus Christ and know that you can have this hope and this peace and these unshakable truths that Jesus has already overcome this world. He's overcome sin and death and the grave. And if you put your faith in him this morning, then you are victorious in him. Not by your works, not by your deeds, not by anything, but by your faith in what Jesus has done for you. Let's pray. Lord, today we praise you for sending us your Son, Jesus. Father, we recognize today that Jesus has overcome this world. He's overcome sin and death and the grave. And the only way that we can be reconciled back to you is putting our faith in Jesus Christ. Father, I pray this morning, as we do every week, that you would continue, and we know that you will, draw unto yourself your own. Father, I pray for the hearts of the ones who've listened to this message today, and may they be encouraged, may they be strengthened, and may they find their hope in what Jesus has done, that he has overcome the world. Father, we thank you for your church and the opportunity we have to serve, to give, and to be your body, the body of Christ here at City Soul Ministries. Father, we give you all the glory, and we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.